where they get sucked up very quickly and lost to this country. They are multi-skilled and highly resourceful, used to working on low budgets, and have a very, very fine ethos that's very, very valuable in the film industry. Very rarely do you get prima donna actors, because
you're not referring to Mel Gibson.
No.
But he has got some habit.
Yes, but that's in his personal life. Let me say about Mel. In his personal life, has been tumultuous and quite dangerous. To work with him is extraordinary. He's there, hardworking, he's a very gifted director and so on. I'm talking about the process of making films.
What do you think about him?
I think he's an absolutely great director. I think Apocalypto is a masterpiece. In a foreign language that no longer spoken, and to keep such tension, Apocalypto is absolutely great. Braveheart, Hansel Ridge, and
The Passion of the Christ?
Well, to be honest, I haven't seen the entire movie. He showed it to me when, he showed it 40 minutes of the movie when it was in a rough cut. And when I watched it, and it was really, really clear that that was a devotional film. I heard the word numinous, which is an important word.
You used it first.
I did.
Yeah,
it.
That's from your text.
Well,
the last line of your text. The Larry Adler lecture to the Sydney Institute.
Oh, it's too long ago.
You forgot the rest.
So, on behalf of all here, we are actually some lovers of your work, got contributed to the world cinema. How do you see the army changing over the last 30 years of the production?
Well, what draws me to cinema more than anything is, I guess, a sense of inquiry, and curiosity. It's a wonderful medium to work in, simply because it's something you can never really master. It involves just so many different aspects of what we call the arts. Written word, performed word, performance without words, composition, music, design, everything, sound. So that's a very, very seductive world to get into and try to make it cohesive. So I hope I've learned. I hope I've learned over time. I think a lot about it, and don't think too much about the films that were made, because you're learning. Not so much in a cerebral way, but out of the process. But in time, you do figure out a few things. And plus, since I started making movies, which is now over 30 years, cinema has changed. Not only the way we tell stories, but also in the audiences have changed. We perceive films much more quickly. We speed read movies compared to and also the technology's changed. The tools are much more plastic, makes simply the image much more plastic, and the tools are much more agile. And it's interesting, you look back and it's quite shocking when you look at the work and say, boy, if only I knew what I know now back then. On the other hand, you're shocked in a good way, and you're surprised. Wow, how did I manage to do that? So it's an interesting process, and which I'm quite grateful.
Yeah, well, for all, because you see amongst us tonight, you see many aspiring cinematographers, many filmmakers. You know, they come from film studies. I want to know what are the rest of the film is all
moving very simply your
imagination through technology. Is technology dominating you, or you dominate technology?
It has to be the storytelling dominates the technology. An artist's brush. I mean, there's a brush tells you, and in some ways, the brush tells you what to paint. But because of the
But who's doing film studies here?
You are the icon of our generation, believe it or not. They love you. When they hear that you will be here, they are flooded with emails. And you can't. Is this for an exclusive club of aficionados or, you know, your wackos? No. this is for you. And your words tonight have been like a testament of beauty.
Oh!
But and you think that's it? I've talked with everybody in Nazi, your versatility in your work. You know, you change so many this way of presenting. I love your melodrama, Lorenzo Zoe, for example. I find it really, really beautiful. I like the other calling melodrama. What's the thematic thread that goes through all your movies?
Well,
is there, if there's...
There is, but it's not a simple thing. It's something that emerges. You know, there's never a simple explanation for anything. But, you know, one is a simple sense of inquiry. The second probably is just trying to understand what it is to tell a story. Why do we tell stories? Why are we in some way hardwired to understand a story or communicate through a story? And ultimately, probably the most important is that one particular story, for whatever reason, gets somewhere in the back of your brain and won't let go. And you're impelled to tell the story. And you can't, there's no way of predicting what that is, but then part of it is this feeling is that there's a feeling that you want to get the story onto the screen and get it in front of people and see what they think, whether or not it connects or resonates with them in some way. That's probably, and it's not, it's never commercial, if you think it is. I've been fortunate enough, my films have done well. But it's always this sort of drive to tell the story. It tends to be something that is uniquely familiar, that in some ways is something we've seen before and pretty timeless. On the other hand, it feels unique, it feels in some way fresh. And if there is a unifying theme, it's almost inevitably the classic hero myth. As very, very brilliantly elucidated by Joseph Campbell, who did us all a massive favor. He spent 40 years in a library after doing some work with you, I think, and trying to find all the commonalities between all folklore, all stories, all mythologies, and ultimately all religions. And he came up with that book, The Hero of a Thousand Faces, which is now overused in Hollywood, but most famously used by George Lucas.
What's the difference between your use and his use? Because he's created a sort of a kind of franchise. He's recreating a brand for the whole thing. I think Joseph Campbell would have been really upset if you have seen the way that the early prequels of Star Wars evolved into the later.
I don't know what he thought of that. Involving the latest one, but I know that he and Joseph Campbell were friends.
Yeah.
But you know, I don't think it's a coincidence that kids growing up, may the force be with you. It's a kind of secular religion. I know that in the United Kingdom, when people had to put down their religion, a very high percentage of people put down Jedi. And it wasn't a joke. I mean, people were seriously there at Jedi weddings and so on. So it is a sense that it has all of those.
We had a wedding, Jedi wedding, in the university.
Did you?
And
there are
75,000 Jedi
reunion
in Australia.
The last
adventure. Oh, that's
really sad. We have to bring you in contact, I think, because they are really in the past department. Yeah.
So I think that what speaks to is, you know, the power of allegory and metaphor. I think what happens is that, as you said, it invites you in. It doesn't tell you what to do.
What's the difference between Mad Max and School Loop Skywalker?
Oh, I think there's a lot of difference. I mean, Mad Max is a pretty twisted, the main character first, is a twisted hero, right? And in fact, the first Mad Max is not a classic. It follows the hero myth. It's basically a revenge saga.
Yeah.
What was interesting, though, I had, and this is how I got on to it. I should go back to your early question. So if you look at Mad Max 2, Babe, Happy Feet, and to some extent Mad Max Fury Road, and certainly Lorenzo's Oil. So think of Mad Max, Babe, Happy Feet, and Lorenzo's Oil, for example, pretty well follow the classic hero. They are basically the agents of the change. They are the means by which we evolve. The distinguishing feature always in the hero is the relinquishing of self-interest in some way. So all of those films have that in common. That it comes a moment where, in some way or another, and one way or another, they have to relinquish their self-interest and go, you probably read about the hero myth, that's in common in all of those stories. And they return to the world, bestow some sort of boon on the world. So that you can track that story through all of those films. If that's one thing, that's right through. But beyond that, the other interesting thing about stories is that they are the eye of the beholder. So they invite audiences in. And it's really amazing how after a time, if a film does have any resonance, how people basically tell we, the filmmakers, what the story is. It takes about, it's accelerating now, but it took about a good 10 years before I even understood what the first Mad Max was. It happened more quickly, but what happened with the first Mad Max is very interesting. It was a very low budget film. It was made, I had never really been on a film set before. We were trying to do something that hadn't been done in Australia, and it wasn't an easy film to make. It was pretty chaotic, and things went wrong. So when we got it finished, I thought it wasn't going to be released. Luckily, what happened was that it seemed to be a hit all around the world except the United States. In Japan, where it first started, they said, Max is a samurai. And I hadn't seen any samurai films. They said, oh, you must have seen all the Kurosawa movies. I said, who's Kurosawa? By the time I got to Mad Max 2, I'd seen every Kurosawa movie. So it was made out of a kind of naivety. However, it had that resonance. When it got to France, they said, oh, this is a Western on wheels. It follows all the classic archetypes of tropes or Western. It's Scandinavia, they recognize it as a broad, low, wandering Viking with all their folklore and so on. So suddenly I thought, hey, wait a minute, I'm not so smart, but I made this film that seemed to do very well. Something else is happening. And luckily, I started reading Campbell and suddenly realized, wait a minute, we unwittingly tapped into the collective unconsciousness and the hero. By the time we got to Mad Max 2, that was much more consciously a classic hero.
But as you said, the global success of this film is really, I would say, impressive, because it didn't grease, but it was in the, you meant in the 70s, we have the point. Period, we have a lot of Burton or Pasolini. Your film came out as an epic form of cinema to this kind of from, say, politicized films and politicized films as well. And you became the hero of the anti-heroes in Europe.
And just looking back, that happened to a certain extent. I know that Mad Max was very controversial. It was, and that in a way made it a hit in some way. Not because it was controversial so much, but people saw things in it that meant something to them. Excuse me. The interesting thing about it was, I remember back then, there was this sense that, oh, because it's full of car action and violence and it's a revenge story, oh, that's a guarantee sort of box office success. Well, the opposite is true, because at the moment people start, there were so many copies of that film, and every one of them, not one of them, ever succeeded. Because they were made, my guess is they were made cynically. They were trying to follow what somebody else had done, and it was too late. It wasn't done sincerely. What looking, you know, probably as a measure of my limited intellectual capacity, when I started making movies, it was purely driven by the vision. I grew up in a culture where art wasn't available to many of us at that time. It was the 60s, and being the son of immigrant parents, my brothers and I, it was all about education. So, you know, I went to medical school with my twin brother and my other brothers did this, and my mother did law. There was nothing available, but I had this thing that I had to always be drawing or painting. And
it's happening in advance in front of the paper, and then you visualize on the screen.
I didn't realize I did that initially, but I realize now that's one thing that is a facility that is sort of innate to me. Someone working with me at one point said, oh, you don't see films. You don't see moments, you see scenes. And until that was pointed out to me, I do have a sense of a scene. It's not definitive, but it sometimes feels fully formed. So it's not hard, you know, that I'm hardwired for that now. I've spent a lot of time.
I should start.
Well, you know, did it? Yeah, but he drew everything down and then he presented it in front of you. The drawings and the designs that he had done, and the most interesting part of his work.
Well, a lot of filmmakers are like that. They can do that. You, by the way, in your spirit, remind me a lot of a good friend, Guillermo del Toro, in the way you draw. you have a wonderful interview. He's a fantastic man. And you have a wonderful time talking.
Guys, what do you have to say? Yes, right. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Love
him. He loved him as a person.
Oh, well.
Spectacular.
Sorry,
let me say, for Mad Max, I'll just get it out. For Mad Max, I was very interested in the visual. I got the opportunity to make a short film as I got through my final medical exam before working in the hospital, and I got my hands on cutting, and had to borrow some equipment to cut. And a very interesting thing happened. I suddenly adding that other dimension of time to the static image, you're suddenly into narrative. It's just, sure, a static image can have narrative, of course, but time forces that narrative. And I never ever thought of that narrative. It was always visual. So I was smart enough to go back, and there were no cinematics in those days, there was no YouTube or whatever. I went back at university, New South Wales University, they had film society, and you'd go, and I went back and watched all the silent movies. And And I realised this new language that's just about 30 years old is an acquired language. Kids learn it before they can learn to read by watching television and so on. And I don't know if you know the Kevin Brownlee book, The Parade's Gone By, but basically he said until the advent of sound, all the language basically can be defined. The close-ups, you know, famously, when you probably know all this film students, for the first time people saw a big close-up, disembodied head, they screamed because they thought it was a disembodied head. They also, you probably know the story, but they saw the steam train go by, they all ran to see it went behind the screen. It's an acquired language, and now the kids watches it very quickly, they know the steam, there's no steam train there, it's just a little window.
Can't distinguish the real life.
Well, there's a certain risk, and there's a certain pathology in that, but I don't think it's, I think for the most part we can.
Real understanding of the language, the narrative force, or the image of the picture, and this kind of things.
Yeah.
And they make them follow as a reality, a simulacrum, you know, something like
that.
You know, Blade Runner.
Yeah.
You know, really. But anyway, now you travel around. What is the position of the Australian cinema worldwide at the moment? Because you are not simply the representative of Australian cinema, you're representative of probably the best representative of a visual language this global. And what about Australian cinema today?
Oh, that's a long story. But
let's hit it short.
Yeah, I'll try to keep it short. It's good and bad. I mean, cinema arises out of culture. If the culture's got something unique to say, then usually the people arise. In the 70s, for instance, in Australia, and you mentioned the Whitlam government, it suddenly let everybody out, into the backyard. Teenagers, we were all teenagers, sort of figuratively saying, being able to voice who we are. A lot of people came back from Britain and Europe and so on and started making movies here. And if you look at the body of work, they're almost always historical films, catching up with our history. Until literally we caught up to modern day and we ran out of history. Our non-Indigenous history is pretty thin on the ground and it's a very much a borrowed history. Cinema is as young as this country and so that's what happened. It happened, we moved into television. My company, Kenny Miller, we did a lot of television, and we literally covered all the historical events. Our first television was the dismissal of the Liberal government. Then we did Bodyline, the one battle Australia had with Mother England, cricket, and so on and so on. Until nowadays, they're making movies of telemovies and miniseries on recent history. So we've caught up on our history. So we then have to move into different genres. Now, what's interesting about Australia is that it's a fantastic place to start to learn your craft. If you fail invisibly. In order to succeed, and it's true, in order to learn your craft, you have to do a lot of things. What happens is that our actors, our cinematographers, our directors, our designers, and so on, when they come.